begin to worship him this morning. Thank you, Jesus. If you have confidence in him, will you express that by way of thanksgiving? Express your confidence in him with thanksgiving this morning. Express your confidence with a way of thanksgiving. Begin to worship him as you express your confidence in him. Hallelujah. In Jesus' precious name. Spirit of God, we thank you this morning. We affirm your power, we affirm your presence. And these have always given us confidence. Lord, I thank you for this gathering. Lord, I thank you for this sent word. In the precious name of Jesus, I decree that someone will receive a sent word today. I decree that in the precious name of Jesus, the word that will lead to someone's liberation will be delivered to him or her in the name of Jesus. Let someone leave this place totally delivered today. All the glory, all the testimonies we will give unto you. In Jesus' precious name. Let's put our hands together for Jesus. Hallelujah. We may be seated. You are welcome this morning in Jesus' precious name. I hope you are very excited. Hallelujah. We give God all the glory. Thank you, Jesus. Before we get into God's word, in case you were not here on Wednesday, the building in Stockton is a done deal. To God be all the glory. We now own that building. All glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Let's celebrate God this morning. Let's give him all the glory. Thank you, Jesus. To him be all the glory. In Jesus' precious name. We may be seated. Our church in building, our church in Stockton now has their building on a 2-acre land. And everything is good to go. But we have allowed the former owners to stay there till the end of February. They requested to the end of February for them to move out completely because they have been there for over 40 years. Yes, they have been there before Highway 5 was constructed. As a matter of fact, the land was the double, but when Highway 5 was constructed, it cut into it. So they lost the other, they didn't lose it. Government paid them for the other half because the other half was cut to the other side of the freeway. That's the truth. So Highway 5 split their land. So they've been there before Highway 5 was built. So they needed, and they are very emotionally attached to the property. But they requested 2 months for them to move out. Plus, we want them to move some junks out of the place. We don't want them to leave any junk behind. So we will give them that. They could pay. I told them they shouldn't have to pay. They should just, 2 months is free. That's not a big deal. Moreover, they are a church too. So glory be to God. We give God all the glory. I've requested that next Saturday after workers' retreat, we will close workers' retreat early. Immediately after workers' retreat, anyone that is interested in going, we will be going there for a site visit. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. This morning, we are going to be starting for the first time in the history of this church 2 services schedules. And I am very excited because this will liberate many people. What you might want to do is to help us noise it around and encourage people, especially those that work night shift, that for one reason or the other, so now this is very convenient for everybody, I believe. So that is good. Also, some of us that we have opportunities to minister, let's stick to time. This is very serious. So if your time is just up when you are leaving, then that would be an infringement. So we have to stick to time, and I'm serious about it than ever before. Also, because there's always a lapse. For example, when the praise and worship intercessory is for 5 minutes, praise and worship is for 20, 15 minutes, and when I look at the time, both of them will now end at 23 minutes. Is it that the lapse from the timers, setters, or from what I've, so we have to fill every gap to be able to achieve this. And the first harvest, we may not be able to guarantee 10-30, but the max we will go is 10-45. So if we are going to do many important things, plus if we have testimonies, which we will always have testimony, when we have testimonies, it becomes a little bit more challenging. So this first harvest, we will publish it to close at 10:45. So the transitional time is just 15 minutes. So meaning that one second service, people are coming in, everyone in first service that you are not staying, you are not permitted to engage them in dialogue. And no matter what is happening in the sanctuary, if you are leading the opening prayer, you have no excuse not to start. If you don't start, it's an infringement. So you have to start. Everything must run on schedule. Now, you don't pray for a system. You don't pray for organization. You don't pray for discipline. You just do it. So it's not what we have to achieve by prayer. It's what everybody has to do, what they are required to do in Jesus' precious name. But if you attend first service, definitely you are not missing anything. You have been in church. If you have attend second, you have not missed anything, because the second will be a duplicate of the first in Jesus' precious name. We are going to look into the word of the Lord this morning. And last week, I started unveiling the requirement of the Holy Ghost, the need for the Holy Ghost in fulfilling our unlimited exploit mandate or God's agenda for us this year. That is the truth. God has spoken. His purpose for you and I this year, what he wants to do is that we all experience exploit in a fashion that there will be no hindrance. So it's going to be like a buffet. When something is unlimited, it means it's a buffet. You have exploit to the level and the degree of your hunger for exploit. That is God's will. But it's very, very important for us to know that it is impossible without the place of the Holy Spirit. And I started talking about that since last week. Can somebody remind me the first thing we dealt with last week? Anybody here? The spirit of what? The spirit of wisdom of God. The spirit of divine, or the spirit of divine wisdom. Hallelujah. This morning, we are going to be pushing it a little bit further. But when you go deeper into the Spirit of God, what is in there is inexhaustible. Praise the Lord. That is talking at the dimension of the Holy Ghost that will push a believer that you must have result. That is walking with the Holy Spirit. Now, because the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God and is also the power of God, is a multi-dimensional manifestations of the personality of God, the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 4 through 7, which is going to be our anchor scriptures for this series, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministry, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but the same God who works all in all. But the manifestations of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. So these manifestations is for our good. Bible says for the profit of all is for us to profit. Is somebody hearing me? But the manifestations of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. Verse says, and there are diversities of activities, but the same God who works all in all. That's why I said there are differences of ministry, yet from still the same God. So we are going to be looking at it in some other dimensions this morning. In 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 7, the Bible says, now to the King immortal, invisible to God, who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever. Who alone is wise? So when we use the word a wise man, we just deceive ourselves. Because when we really talk about wisdom, it's only God that is wise. That's what the Bible says. Now, as we begin to enter into what is in God's wisdom, this morning we're going to look at the spirit, number one, the spirit of guidance. The spirit of guidance in exploring the diversities of the Holy Spirit to our profiting, we must recognize the spirit of guidance. Praise the Lord. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 4, the Bible says, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God." The Bible calls men and women sons. Do you understand that? So that's the language of the Bible. So the Bible is not discriminatory, but that's just what it is because of the old culture. Now, the Bible says, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons and daughters of God." So without allowing God to lead you, you must, for your sonship, for who you are in Christ to be complete, you must allow the Holy Spirit to lead you. Are we following me? Are you following me? In John chapter 6 and verse 13 to 14, the Bible says, "However, when the Spirit of truth has come, He will guide you to all truth, for He will not speak on His own authority. But whatever He hears, He will speak. He will tell you things to come. He will glorify me, for He will take of what is mine and declare to you." So when the Spirit of God, which is the Spirit of truth, He will... You know how many journey people embark on false direction in life? You know how many things people do on wrong diagnosis? Praise the Lord. Some people have been killed, some people have died just because the diagnosis of the doctors were wrong. So there are many destinies that has been sent on a wrong journey just because they lack the manifestations of the Spirit of truth. So we are looking into the spirit of guidance. Hallelujah. The collapse of many great potentials have been traced to going in the wrong way of life, taking the wrong step, making a wrong decisions. A wrong decision can pull down a destiny, no matter how glorious that destiny is. A wrong step. So that is the importance of acknowledging and embracing the spirit of guidance. No matter how much energy you put in the wrong thing, wrong is wrong. It can never be right. Do you understand what I'm saying? Is somebody following me? Many a times, things going great, a wrong step can mess it all up. Just one decision, one day. Are you following me this morning? In Isaiah chapter 45, the Bible says, "Thus says the Lord to His anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held." In other words, I'm leading him. "Whose right hand I have held." So when I'm leading him, I'm leading him to subdue nations before him. So when God is the one leading, there is no opposition that can stand. He says, "And loose the hammer of kings to open before him double doors so that the gate will not be shut." Because nobody closes any door, any gate against God if he's ahead. When God is the one leading, every door must open. When God is leading, every supply must come. When God is leading, everything works. When God is leading. Now, people will think you are a star. You are not. You are just enjoying the privilege or divine guidance. Praise the Lord. So now, then is the opposite when God is not there. Every opposition becomes insurmountable when God is not there. Verse 2 says, I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. Now, if he's leading, he makes straight the crooked places. And I will break in pieces the gate of bronze and the cut the bars of iron. I will give you the treasure of darkness, if he's leading. And hidden riches of secret places, if he's leading. In other words, when God is leading you, there are places that you will tap financial resources from that nobody knows. And it's not fraudulent. God will just open some doors that things will get done with no effort. Praise the Lord. That so that you may know that I, the Lord, will call you by your name. And I'm so now I will reveal myself to you if you allow me to lead you. Now, as I was meditating on this, I don't want to sound a little bit political, but you understand what I'm saying. Now, I've lifted the president-elect in prayer several times. But you know, I began to think about divine direction. The only two things that messed up the chances of Hillary was accepting to become the Secretary of State. The Benghazi issue and the email, until she stepped in to take that role, she was clean. Nothing would have been able to use against her. In fact, the offense she committed to Putin that led to the hackings was what she said when she discredited the election of Putin in her term as the Secretary of State. So before she had stepped into that position, Putin didn't care about her. Before she stepped into that position, there was no email scandal. Before she stepped into that position, there was no Benghazi issue. Now ask me if she had sought the Holy Spirit. Does it look good on the resume to become the Secretary of State? It can't be better than that. What test do you want to have? That is the most senior cabinet position. That is the one everybody seeks after. Some people, if they don't give them that one, they don't want any other one. That is the most senior cabinet position. Has more influence in any government in America than the vice president. So, the Bible said there is a way that seems right to a man. All this seems right to all of us. The Bible said the end of it is death. So, imagine if she was born again and the Holy Spirit said, take your time, don't take it. Is somebody hearing me? The spirit of guidance. Let me tell you this morning, you are incapable of recognizing the right path without the Holy Spirit. God is very humorous. As I was meditating about the depth of the Holy Spirit brought this to my mind. Then when she, immediately after she finished serving as Secretary of State, they celebrated her. But all these things were underneath. Imagine if she had remained as ex-senator of New York, be preparing to run for election. Do you understand what I'm saying? The spirit of guidance. There is a way. It seems right to a man. You know, when we go in the wrong direction, because we lack the opportunity to know what could have been, so we miss that one out, then we don't know what wrong directions has cost us. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So he said, because I am the one leading him, I will lead him to subdue nations. He says, it means I will level obstacles and lead him to hidden treasures. I will show him opportunities for money. That's why that scripture was saying in Isaiah chapter 45. If you allow God to lead you, he will lead you into exploits. That's a good place to say amen. If you allow him to lead you, he will lead you into plenty. In Psalms 23, the Bible says, the Lord is my shepherd. In other words, God is the one leading me. Then I shall not want. So we grow up praying Psalm 23 as prayer. You pray it and go. No, take it easy. Now, Psalm 23 is an instruction. He said, because God is the one leading me, that you read it and leave doesn't mean God is the one that has led. So he's only telling you that because God is the one leading me, that's the reason why I shall not want. David was giving his own testimony. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. So if the pastures where you are lying is not where God has led you, then how can he be the one leading? Then he said, he leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. Now, verse 4 is important. He said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. So if God is the one leading you, no one can touch you. He said, I shall fear no evil. Where God led you, there is no enemy that can kill you. If God is the one leading, because he's also the one fighting. Is someone following me? In Genesis chapter 26, the Bible says from verse 1, there was a famine in the land beside the first famine. That was in the days of Abraham. And Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines, in Gerar. Then the Lord appeared to him and said, do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land which I shall tell you. Dwell in this land, and I will perform. And I perform the oath which I swore. Now, this time was a time of famine where nothing works. And what made sense was for everybody to relocate to where there were opportunities. Do not go to Egypt. Now, Egypt was the center of wealth, center of attraction, center of the world. Egypt was what United States is now to the world then. Then the Holy Spirit said, don't go there. Stay here. That won't make sense. Hallelujah. Now, because God always had another plan. In Genesis 26, verse 12, the Bible says, then Isaac sowed in that same land and reaped in that same year 100-fold. And the Lord blessed him. Why? Because God said him stay. Praise the Lord. Is somebody hearing me? The man began to prosper and continued prospering until he became very prosperous. So when it is exploit, when it is God, it is not going to agree with logic. So what do? We look at location, state by state, towns by towns. We look at opportunities. But that is the one you are doing by yourself. But if it is God, God can bring plenty out of the one that makes no sense. Is somebody hearing me? The one that we call that has no prospect. Now the Bible says he became very prosperous, for he had possessions of flock, possessions of herds, a great number of servants, to the point that the Philistines, they now envied him. So there is no one, when the Bible says God is the only wise God, there is no one that operates in God's class when it comes to wisdom. Because whatever he says becomes a law. What is wisdom to us is mostly foolishness to him, and we consider his own wisdom, we consider it doesn't make sense. That's how we brush aside everything God says, because we don't agree with it. Now, we won't in our whole mind say it doesn't make sense, but we just won't do it. And the reason is because it doesn't make sense to us. So we go another direction. Now, there is nothing that God says that your natural mind will be able to comprehend without the help of the Holy Spirit. God always tells people what doesn't make sense. Every time God tells you something that doesn't make sense, a breakthrough, a miracle is in the making. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1 from verse 18, the Bible says, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. The message of Jesus, in other words, everything God will do because of the cross. Now, everything we have, church, body of Christ, is because of the cross. So the message that comes, how it will guide you, the Bible says it is foolishness to the unredeemed. But even them, you that you are the redeemed of the Lord, you must be alert in the spirit. But say, but to us who are being saved, that foolishness, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. So where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? Verse 21 says, for since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those that will believe. So when you align yourself with the foolishness or the message of God or the wisdom of God, it's for your safety, the Bible says. Verse 24 says, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. And verse 25 says, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. So what he's saying is that if somebody hits you, and the Holy Spirit says, don't hit back, you look weak. But God is saying, you are the stronger one. The weakness of God is stronger than men. So when the Holy Spirit tells you something and you do it, it looks foolish. Just as it may look foolish to somebody that we started the second service. We broke the service into two. But it is God's wisdom. Now, the wisdom of God will always appear foolish to those that don't know what God is saying. Do we understand where we're going? Praise the Lord. But let's read verse 25 together, everyone. Let's read. One more time, let's read louder. One more time, let us read. When you get to a point that whatever God says, you no longer call it foolish, you have entered a realm of unlimited exploit. Why? Because inside this foolishness, God always wants to prove himself so that you can know this is God. Praise the Lord. Now, we just finished the purchase of the building in Stockton. There is no any man, including myself, that can lay claim to the glory. This is entirely what God did. This is entirely the doing of God. Now, when the Lord told me, let's go for building, and I called Pastor Peter, there was nothing happening at that time that should, if I call a meeting, nobody will agree. But God said, it's time to do it. And effortlessly, I only went to Stockton once. Only once. And we saw this building. Now, they sent four buildings to me originally. I disqualified two on the papers. I said, these two, let me see them. I went to see the two. The one that was good was in the worst part of Stockton. The good one, the good property. So I said, well, let's see. The real agent, they just told me, there is another agent that suggested one building somewhere. Since you are here, can you just see it? That's why you were with me. Can you just see it? I said, okay, why not? Let's go. I said, how many minutes? They said 7 minutes. I said, okay, it's on our way. Let's just go there. And it happened to be these 2 acres property. Praise the Lord. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men. The enemy of enjoying divine direction is your mind. If you can overcome your mind, because it's your mind, your intellect, that challenges God's wisdom. If you can overcome it, you will be walking in a zone that heavens will be carrying you in order to do. The enemy of enjoying divine direction, enjoying the power of God, is your mind that will not stop telling you he doesn't make sense. Praise the Lord. You know how many things Holy Spirit tells us quietly that we just act as if we didn't hear? Yeah, the Bible tells us in Isaiah chapter 55 and verse 8, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways." So the heavens and the earth can never meet. So he's saying your way of thinking and my way of reason can never cross. So until you obey him in that thing that looks foolish, you are not set to enjoy his backing. Number two, the spirit of servanthood. So this is beyond talking about serving. I'm talking about having the spirit of servanthood. Now, hear this morning, without serving, with every service, everything we do, without the spirit of servanthood, is not an acceptable service, and I'll show you in scripture shortly. So when it comes to serving God in an acceptable way, you have to have the heart of a servant. And I was thinking about it. Now, so how does a servant behave? Servant has no voice against their master. When God speaks, whatever it takes to serve God is not a servant don't have opinions. So I'm talking beyond just I'm not encouraging you to serve now. I'm telling you what it takes. So there is, it's possible to serve, and the service is unacceptable. And I found out from scripture, and by the help of the Holy Ghost, that number one thing, if you are going to serve in an acceptable way, you're going to have to remove your right. You can't serve God with a civil right mind. I'm sure those people begin to convict some of us. You cannot serve him with a mind of entitlement. The spirit of servanthood is serving God with humility without any sense of pride. Without any sense of arrogance. And without any sense of reputation. Most likely, somebody, if not the three, will fall into one. Serving God without any sense of pride, in other words, who you are. Serving God without arrogance. Serving God without a reputation, consciousness of your reputation. Don't let anybody deceive you. There is nothing more rewarding than serving God with an attitude of a servant. It won't make sense. That is why when you see somebody that have embraced this spirit or God has imparted, people call them fools. People call them, they are using you. People call them, they are taking advantage of you. People call them all kinds of things. Now, this is the truth. You can say, I say, Satan sent them. You know, human beings are Satan. So, it's Satan that speaks through people. Whatever anybody says to discourage your service of to God, it is Satan speaking, not that person. Praise the Lord. You remember that's what happened to Peter? Jesus quickly rebuked him. He cast him out. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. In Luke chapter 22, the Bible says from verse 24, "Now there was also a dispute among them as to which of them should be considered the greatest. And he said to them, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those who exercise authority over them are called benefactors. But not so among you. On the contrary, he who is greatest among you, let him be as the younger. You know, that already doesn't make sense with our thinking. He's saying the greatest one is the, yes, in our own thinking, the natural mind, the younger one is, shut up. But he said that one is the one that, so he's only saying, if you are the one that won't have a voice, that can say, my friend, keep quiet, do what you are doing. He said you are the greater one. So the one that carry himself as the authority, that give, he said, is the smaller one. Praise the Lord. For, verse 27, for who is greater, he who sits at the table or he who serves? Does that make sense? So Jesus is saying in kingdom service, the one that is carrying the pot, the one that is carrying the plate, the one that is that doesn't have a table, is greater than the ones on the high table. Now, some people do it, will serve that much. You know, when they run into trouble, they complain. Servant don't complain. So when the one at the table say, bring this water. Brings, no, I don't want it. I want hot. Take it back. Say, I changed my mind. I want soda. Then you brought Coke. He said, no, Sprite. Four times. You've gone back. He said, you know, I don't want anything. Take all this anyway. Go and look for anything you think I would like. The servant say, yes, sir. How many of us will serve that way? He will spill the cup on his face. How many of us? I'm trying to tell you the difference between a servant and, you know, servant don't complain. You know, in the slavery days, there was a time that they will, servant, they will cut their leaves and put a lock, like a door. And they will be there when they are doing it. When they are perforating their leaves. Thank you, Jesus. He says, verse 28, but you are those who have continued with me in my trials. So, as you continue with him in trial, you serve with the heart of a servant. Then it is you I bestow upon you a kingdom. So, the kingdom is only for servants. So, leadership is not occupying a seat. Leadership is an opportunity to serve. Leadership is an in the kingdom of God, leadership is an opportunity to serve. Without a spirit of servanthood, you can easily be recruited into rebellion. You know, that's how Satan used to be able to work on our emotions. Somebody would just say, is it only you are doing too much? Then you start thinking about it. It's true. It's true. When you are coming back tomorrow, you are coming with a determination to fight. All night, you have thought about what you have done that others have not done. Somebody has told us, with the spirit of servanthood, somebody said, you are doing too much. He said, thank you, God bless. Praise the Lord. With the spirit of servanthood, there's nothing anybody can say that you can be offended. You know what the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 42? Behold my servant, from verse 1, whom I uphold. My elect one, in whom my soul delights, I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the Gentiles. Verse 2 says, he will not cry out, nor raise his voice, nor cause his voice to be heard in the street. So the spirit of servanthood is the immunization against any manipulation of Satan. So, when you have the spirit of a servant, when you are serving, it's not for public talk. I'm the only one that does this. Now, the truth is this. A servant does everything, regardless of what others are not doing. Are you following me? The spirit of servanthood is serving God without seeking attention. The spirit of servanthood is serving God without picking our references. If there are things you are capable of doing, but you can't do it because you don't like it, or you don't want it to mess up with your personality, you are not serving with the spirit of servanthood. If you are capable of doing it, for example, if you are very good at cleaning and you are not in janitorial, the only reason why, if you clean your house very well, you are very good with cleaning, but you can't serve God in that capacity, it's because you are selfish. Because you are good at it. Does that make sense? For example, if your reason for not wanting a department is because people will be dragging you too much, it's too noisy. You don't servants don't determine which one they want. Are you following me? Praise the Lord. The spirit of servanthood is serving God without making noise and serving God without acrimony. It is serving God without generating or attracting controversy. It is serving God without any claim to any right. Praise the Lord. In Philippians chapter 2 and verse 5, the Bible says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also." I pray that the Holy Spirit will help us to be able to handle this message. So it's a spirit of servanthood. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but he made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bond servant. So himself came as a bond servant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in that, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death. Then God highly, Bible say, exalted him. So it's not every service in God's house that qualifies for honor. It is serving him with a heart of a servant. John chapter 12 and verse 26. John 12, 26, the Bible says, "If anyone serves me, let him follow me. And where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, him my Father will honor." You know, that is his own definition of serving, which we read earlier on. So, is the one that serves me, that serves with the heart of servanthood, him my Father will honor. So the spirit of servanthood will always lead to change of levels. Without this spirit, arrogance and pride will abort your interest in the kingdom service. And I close by saying in Job 36 and verse 11, the Bible says, "If they obey and serve him, they shall spend their days in plenty." And now, Job wrote this scripture. Job testified, Job was the wealthiest man in his time in all the East. He said, so Job was testifying that obedience got him to where he was. Job was not a pastor, was a businessman. If they obey and serve him, if you obey and serve him, you spend your days in pleasures, your years in pleasure, the days in prosperity, if they obey and serve him, can we rise to our feet? If they obey and serve him, let's lift up our voice and ask for grace for that spirit. Let's ask God for that spirit. Let's draw grace for that spirit. Let's draw grace for that spirit. You must draw grace for this spirit because you cannot do it acceptably without the spirit of a servanthood. Let's ask God for this grace. The spirit of servanthood, the spirit of guidance. In fact, without the spirit of servanthood, it's difficult to be guided by the Holy Spirit. Let's open our mouth and ask the Lord in prayer. Ask for this spirit. Ask for this spirit. Ask the Holy Spirit to humble you. Ask for the Holy Spirit to touch your heart. Lift up your voice and begin to pray. In Jesus' mighty name. We are going to spend a few minutes to pray. We are in the prayer, 21-day prayer and fasting going on. God spoke to us at the beginning of this year. This year is the year of a limited exploit, and it has started already. I want to open your mouth and ask the Lord. I come against every force that will resist my unlimited exploit in 2017. I come against all the forces in the name of Jesus. Every force, every power that will want to limit, resist, contend with my exploit in 2017. I come against it in the name of Jesus. Lift up your voice and begin to ask the Lord in prayer. Open your mouth and begin to ask God. Open your mouth and begin to ask God. Every power, every force in the precious name of Jesus that may want to serve as an hindrance to my exploit in 2017, I come against it in the name of Jesus. Lift up your voice and begin to pray. Open your mouth and begin to pray. Lift up your voice. In the name of Jesus, come on, open your mouth and begin to pray. Somebody pray, ask the Lord, come on, pray. Pray to the Lord. Lift up your voice. Lift up your voice. Lift up your voice. Begin to ask Him in prayer. Begin to ask God in prayer. Begin to ask God in prayer. Begin to ask God in prayer. Somebody lift up your voice and pray. Lift up your voice and pray. Lift up your voice and pray. In Jesus' mighty name. We are going to lift up our voice and pray. The Bible says a man that will not walk should not eat. So in other words, when a man walks, that man is qualified for every good things of life. We are going to pray for miracle good jobs. For some people may have jobs that they don't know is not good enough. That God in His power will, to everyone's, the fullness of each one's potentials, that miracle jobs, miracle businesses for all our business people, great careers, in the name of Jesus, by the wisdom and the power of God, be delivered to us, to all our members in 2017. Let's lift up our voice and begin to pray. Lord, we pray for miracle jobs, breakthrough jobs, in the name of Jesus. Breakthrough jobs, breakthrough jobs. Breakthrough jobs for all our members. Everyone that desire a change of job. Everyone that desire a change of levels. Those in business. Those with careers. In the precious name of Jesus, I pray for a breakthrough in the areas of employment. I pray for a breakthrough. Lift up your voice and begin to pray. Somebody open your mouth over every member of this church. Everyone to be gainfully employed. Everyone to be gainfully employed. In the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and begin to pray. 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 Great job, sir. Lift up your voice. 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 In Jesus' mighty name, we are also going to pray. In the precious name of Jesus, we are committing the health of every member of this church into the hands of the Lord. That everyone that is sick, that the power of God will deliver, will heal. We forbid sickness and infirmity. In the precious name of Jesus, we rebuke every spirit of infirmity. Lift up your voice and begin to pray. Over all members of Dominion Life, we rebuild the power of sickness. We rebuild the power of infirmity. In the precious name of Jesus, we rebuild the power of sickness. We rebuild the hold of infirmity. You foul spirit of sickness, over the earth, over the lives of our members, remove your hand in the name of Jesus. I command you to remove your hand in the name of Jesus. I command you to remove your hand in the name of Jesus. I command you to remove your hand in the name of Jesus. In the precious name of Jesus, everyone will walk in full health. Everyone will walk in sound health. Lift up your voice and ask the Lord in prayer. Somebody open your mouth and ask God in prayer. In Jesus' mighty name. Let us thank God for answer prayer in faith. Let's give him all the glory. Let's give him all the honor. In Jesus' precious name. We may be seated. It is time to worship God with our offerings and our tithe this morning. It is time we worship God with our offerings and our tithe. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. If you are writing a check, you simply write to the church, Dominion Life Christian Center. And don't forget, you can fill in your credit card on the envelopes. And if that is your choice, the 3-digit or 4-digit security code is very, very important for us to be able to process your offering. And also, you can text it in. The number is on the screen. 925-359-9133. You can text in your offering. You just text as it is. If it's an offering, text offering and put the amount in front of it. If it is tithe, you do the same thing with the right words on the screen. Hallelujah. It is time we worship God with our offering. Also, you can give in cash. You can write a check. Thank you, Jesus. And please, mark your offering. Let's know if it is a tithe, if it is whatever it is, let us know. In Jesus' precious, if it's a mission offering, that is very, very important. It is time we worship God now.